So, Lord of the Rings, is it going anywhere anytime soon?
I mean, it would appear that the series has officially retired from the silver screen, but that is not stopping the Land of Middle-earth from showing up in other mediums. I mean, if you were to ignore the fact that a Silmarillion adaptation is going to get greenlit sooner or later, you still got the upcoming TV adaptation courtesy of Amazon, of which will reportedly have a budget of $1 billion.
You want to know how insane that is?
That's more than the budget of all three Lord of the Rings films and all three Hobbit films combined.
I hope you know what you're doing, Jeff. Now, who am I kidding? $1 billion is like chump change to you.
But this show is still a way off, so what can you do if you're itching for a bit of LOTR right now?
Well, the guys over at Monolith have got you covered.
Enter their Middle-earth Shadow Duology for current-gen consoles. Now, today's video is all about the latest iteration, Shadow of War. But let's just briefly touch upon Shadow of Mordor first. For a lot of you who've never touched these games before, I might be wondering if Mordor can be skipped. In other words, could you play War without ever playing Mordor?
And yes, you could, but I wouldn't advise it.
You see, Shadow of Mordor can be picked up pretty cheaply now, and it's a terrific game in its own right. Plus, many story elements in War might confuse you if you never play through Mordor. Oh, and if you buy the Game of the Year edition, it'll give you all released DLC built into the disc, which makes picking the game up right now cracking value for money.
So let's say you've beaten Shadow of Mordor. Should you pick up War? Maybe. Let me explain.
Number 1. Fuck canon! So Shadow of War takes place after the events of Mordor, as Taliesin and Celebrimbor have fashioned themselves a new ring of power to take on Sauron's. And the plot of the game is simple. The two must use their newfound power to recruit their own army of orcs to take over Mordor, and dethrone the Dark Lord for good, all while various subplots keep the two busy on their adventure.
Yeah, it's a simple story, and there's honestly not that much to keep you invested in the characters, but there's some enjoyment to be had here with the various directions the story takes.
For starters, I like how this game isn't canon. Yeah, a lot of Lord of the Rings fans might not like that, but in this age of cinematic universes and media that must adhere to what other media in the same franchise already laid out, it's refreshing to see a project that explores an alternate timeline in its respective franchise. The Ringwraiths, for example, get some more attention here, and it was interesting to see some of these guys get a little backstory. We also get to see what Minas Morgul looked like under Gondorian rule. There's some interesting magical creatures you come across, including some fan favourites.
And Shelob, yeah, that giant spider that Sam takes on in Return of the King.
Turns out she's actually some seductive, sexy Maya lady.
What?
Yeah, that's a little out there, guys. I mean, that'd be like a future Star Wars game where the Rancor turned out to be some sexy hunk played by Channing Tatum. Now, it sounds incredibly dumb, I know, but it honestly didn't bother me that much.
I like how Monolith took some chances here, and throughout the game, there's some legitimately intriguing reveals that made me go,
huh, how about that shit? Shame this isn't canon, actually. With that being said, the story is more there just to move the game along.
It is pretty lackluster, and a lot more could have been done with it. Taliesin himself is unfortunately a bit of a bore, and there's not that much to latch onto with him. Same with Celebrimbor. But their characters are saved somewhat by their excellent voice actors. Troy Baker once again doing a great job, but I gotta give mad props to Celebrimbor's VOA, Alistair Duncan, because his voice is just fucking cool.
The Nazgul is entirely focused on the ritual. This is the perfect time to strike.
That guy could read fucking Humpty Dumpty and he would still sound menacing.
But back to the plot, and it's really more character depth that could have added so much more here. For example, we come across some Gondorian soldiers who had a great basis to be really interesting, but as the game goes on, they take more of a backseat to the adventure, and all momentum their story accumulates just vanishes. Like, why not develop Idril's relationship with her father a bit more? After all, there's something he does that should have had a profound effect on her. But it really doesn't. Oh, and then there's Baranor here, and this guy had so much squandered potential, as we find out he was originally one of the Haradrim, but now he's a Gondorian soldier.
Wow, that sounds fascinating.
We've seen the Haradrim in the movies, but we know next to nothing about them. What an opportunity to explore their culture. What mysteries could finally be unveiled about these guys?
Well, sadly, in this case, none. Yeah, they introduce the first black character in Lord of the Rings and they do next to nothing with him.
I mean, maybe there could have been a flashback mission to his time as a Haradrim, where you could play as him. There also could have been a mission where he runs into his old Haradrim friends, and then he has an inner conflict when he's told to kill them. Maybe he could have had a relationship with Idril here, and his Haradrim heritage could play into that somehow, as Gondorians and Haradrim are sworn enemies. You know, like Capulets and Montagues. I swear there was a romance hinted at between these two, but they go nowhere with it. It's just all such a missed opportunity to give some depth to our heroes. Now, there does actually appear to be further content coming down the line that might explore these characters more, but it's locked behind a pretty pricey season pass. Yeah, I'll talk about this later.
Now, what Monolith have instead capitalized on here are actually the orcs.
I mean, it's a little strange that the guys you kill have more personality than the guys you're trying to protect, but they're still great. They're not hampered by the language of Tolkien, for all the good guys talk like British people did 100 years ago.
The orcs talk like British people do now.
Like, the dialogue they spew out would feel out of place at your local pub.
Well, minus the bits where they're talking about eating man flesh, but apart from that, it's pretty spot on.
I totally have a pint with Bruce here, providing he doesn't rip my head off. But back to the plot, and where I think it actually falters the most is the ending. Now, it's not as bad as it was in Shadow of Mordor, because there is at least an actual boss fight, not just a crap quicktime event. But all the subplots just fizzle out with no real closure, and the last stretch of the game is just several hours of non-stop gameplay with a final meh cutscene at the end.
Yeah, it doesn't leave the greatest last impression.
But regardless, I still enjoyed the character interactions and the really neat things they do with the lore. But trust me, the actual game on offer here is the actual selling point. So let's now talk about that. Number 2, let us hunt some orc. Now, if I were to explain what kind of game Shadow of War is, imagine if the Batman Arkham games had a baby with Assassin's Creed, and that game got a Lord of the Rings makeover. Yeah, that's exactly this game. As Talion, you travel around a free-roaming Mordor, undertaking various missions, collecting things, and killing a shitload of orcs. Now, the meat of the game is the combat system, which remains largely unchanged from Shadow of Mordor. And it's basically Talion Arkham Asylum here. Strike when you can, counter when necessary, and avoid getting hit to get that multiplier up. And yeah, I can't stress enough how similar this is to the Arkham games. Stealth is a factor to help thin out the ranks, mission structure is identical, you unlock new abilities as you level up.
Now, I'm not dissing the game at all for this, I'm just simply pointing out the similarities.
And the combat, whilst familiar, is still a lot of fun.
And challenging when it should be.
You see, it's not a game where you can just run into a couple dozen of enemies and go to town. It's easy to get overwhelmed, even on the lower difficulties.
You see, the game rewards perceptive players.
You gotta keep your eye open for these button prompts to make sure you counter or dodge in time. And other environmental factors can help too. Like you can shoot Morgul fly nests to disrupt your enemies, you can hit explosive barrels of grog, or you can shoot open creature cages and put meat back on the menu, boys!
Now, there are a couple slight issues with the combat system.
First off, and I feel a lot of you might disagree, and maybe I'm in denial, but I kept swearing that I hit the counter button at the right time and it didn't register.
Again, this might just be me. Let me know in the comments if you felt the same.
Now, it didn't happen a lot, but it got a bit annoying sometimes.
And the second issue is that aiming at specific enemies is really fiddly.
For example, stronger enemies like Orc Captains and Ringwraiths can be defeated by draining them. But more often than not, I ended up draining other nearby Orcs. This meant the endings to a lot of fights far more infuriating than they should have been. Perhaps a way to change your target mid-drain could have fixed this. This was what annoyed me most about the combat, and it led to some pretty infuriating deaths.
Now, regarding the stealth, technically there is something wrong here. You see, it's very forgiving.
The orcs' reaction times are incredibly slow. You can literally execute them from the front and they won't notice you. But because Mordor is absolutely loaded with orcs, the forgiving stealth does actually favour the game's design. It's definitely a combat game first, stealth second, so the forgiving stealth you'll find isn't really much of an issue. There's still plenty of challenge here.
However, outside of combat, you'll find little in the way of challenge.
Number 3.
We have work to do.
So yeah, when you're not slicing up orcs, this is where the Assassin's Creed similarities come in. Each region of Mordor has towers you climb to get a lay of the land.
Sound familiar?
and on top you can scan the region for nearby collectibles and objectives. There's walls you can scan that unlock a door with secret loot. There's artifacts you can collect which Idril gives you some backstory on. There's memory fragments that give Shelob a bit more backstory. There's challenge missions where you play as Killer Brimbor, where you gotta take out orcs under certain parameters.
And when you combine all that with all the other missions available, you'll realize the sheer enormity of things to do here.
Which is great if you're a gamer on a budget. Buy Shadow of War if you like your games long, as you can expect to spend upwards of 50 hours here, which for a third-person action game is pretty impressive.
With that being said, the game can get a bit monotonous for all the budding completionists out there, especially when you gotta collect things.
Got that artifact. Set a waypoint to go over here. Get that artifact. Set another waypoint. Go over here. Got that one too. On to the next one.
You see what I mean? A lot of the objectives here can feel like a checklist, and it makes the game feel more like a chore at times.
This is something a lot of free roam games suffer from, and very few go about it the right way.
Dear video game developers, in order to make collectibles appealing, there needs to be some sort of challenge associated with attaining them.
Like a puzzle you gotta solve, or a powerful enemy in the way. In fact, I remember a Graug actually blocking the way to a collectible on one occasion here. That made attaining the item far more rewarding. Why can't we have more of that?
Tell me, people, what is the appeal of seeing an item on the map, setting a waypoint, going to that point on the map, and picking it up?
It's not fun, it's not challenging, it's just a ploy from the developers to pad the game's runtime. I get that collectibles are optional, but forgiving shitty game design just because you don't have to play it is not a valid excuse. All objectives in a game should be fun. Simple as that. And collecting shit in Shadow of War is often not fun.
And said shit you collect is not that great in and of itself.
There's gems you collect to upgrade your stats, and there's many weapon and equipment drops too.
But Monolith went way overboard with the gear drops here.
Let's take swords for example. You collect new ones all the time, which means you'll be swapping out old swords for new ones all the time. And each sword usually has like 2 or 3 extra damage, so you'll never notice any notable improvement. A lot of RPGs are guilty of this, where certain gear is only slightly better than other gear, which makes upgrading said gear feel really lackluster.
Like, you know when you play Zelda,
and you finally get the Master Sword, and you feel like a fucking boss with it? Yeah, I want that feeling more in my RPGs. You just do not get that here.
Oh, you mean my weapon has a 33% chance of poison compared to the 29% chance it had before? Woo!
Leveling up feels a bit off too. You see, every time you do, you get a point you can spend on new skills. And whilst there's some cool abilities like taking over dragons and chaining stealth kills, a lot of these abilities I just never used. There's the ability to throw knives.
It does next to nothing.
There's an ability to shoot enemies in the foot to freeze them in place.
Never used it.
There's something called Elven Rage, which puts you in a sort of killing frenzy.
It doesn't feel gratifying at all to use.
There's an ability to poison grog barrels.
But the orcs take so long to drink it, I'm better off just killing them normally anyway.
And then there's the unlock, which makes it so that you automatically pick up items, as opposed to hitting a button to pick them up.
Why the hell is that an unlock?
That's not an upgrade, that's just better game design. Imagine if you had to unlock the ability to automatically pick up coins in Super Mario Brothers. This design choice is just baffling.
But enough of that. Let's finally get around to talking about the defining feature of these games, the Nemesis system.
Number 4.
You will submit.
So the Nemesis system continues over from Shadow of Mordor, and it's still really cool.
Across Mordor are orc captains you can run into. Now these guys are stronger than your average orc, and each time you encounter one, they all have a little something to say.
All this work just to die at my hands. You men are fools.
We're going to pull you apart, one bloody chunk at a time.
I love this. It gives all these guys heaps of personality, and you'll be subject to a whole manner of different reactions when playing. You might laugh.
I'm gonna give you a splitting headache. Because I'm gonna hit you. In the head. And it'll hurt. Like a headache, only worse.
You might get legitimately intimidated when an orc who's killed you before shows up. Or you might just be there like, what the fuck?
insignificant.
Another great thing about this is the sheer amount of dialogue recorded. Not once in my 50 hours of playing did I hear any repeated lines. That is impressive.
Now, when fighting these guys, there's two options.
You can either kill them for some new equipment, or you can recruit them to your army. Now, once recruited, you can do several things with them. You can send them out on missions to kill other orcs. You can set one as your own personal bodyguard. You can send one to infiltrate and betray other orcs of power. You can also send them to the fight pits for extra awards and experience.
They'll level up when you do that too, so yeah, they sort of become like Pokemon.
Yeah, they come in various power levels, which makes some more valuable than others. They each have their own strengths and weaknesses.
Yeah, they turn orcs into Pokemon. God, that is going to change the bloody Poke rap, isn't it?
Okay, guys, we're going to wrap some orcs and uruks.
You just do the saying. I'll take care of the hard part.
Let's get it on!
I want to slice some heads, make them drink through straws to consume all the orcs. Yeah, that's my cause.
Snafu, Mazu, Booth, and Cougar, Onka, Hakon, Zoon, and Horza, Ruga, Janek, Nordic, Baga, Nazu, Rakduk, Angu, Lezidar.
Family, bet your ass I'm pissed. With this ring of power, I'll make them all my bitch.
Gala, Hissu, Vlog, and Ezra. Goleman, Nosko, Takra, Zugo. Borgu, Bolgashkan, and Doomza. Skak, and Grubu, Pasha, Zoo.
Gotta train them all.
Yeah.
Gotta train them all.
Yeah. Gotta train them all,
PokeOrcs. Honestly, it makes me wish there was a built-in Pokedex for these guys. Jeez.
But this is actually a relatively small aspect of the game, and most of everything else I've talked about could actually be done in Shadow of Mordor. So, what's truly different in War? What's the big new thing here?
Well, this is where siege battles come into place.
Throughout the campaign, you'll have various fortresses you'll need to attack or defend with your orc army. Here, you can assign orcs to lead the assault, you can use in-game currency to acquire new orcs, or buy siege upgrades to make the battle easier. And yeah, these large-scale battles are fun and all, I'm certainly glad they're here.
But honestly, there's not much to them.
In them, you admittedly capture a few control points and fight a final boss at the end, but it honestly just feels like any other part of the game. You go from point A to point B and kill a fuckton of orcs. That's it. I mean, there's things you can do in order to prepare for these battles, like recruiting more orcs or doing more missions to acquire silver to buy upgrades, but guess what? This is done by killing more orcs.
You see, for a 50 plus hour game, Shadow of War doesn't have much in the way of variety.
These siege battles are advertised as the new defining feature in Shadow of War, but it's really not much of a feature. This is where the game should have employed some strategy game elements, like you could choose where to position your orcs, deeper customization would have been nice, and maybe there could even be a Sims-like feature where you could redesign your fortress.
Ooh, I'll put a trebuchet there. Here I'll have my Caragor riding warrior stationed. Here I'll have my archers all on the wall there for backup. Yeah, there's nothing like that.
And even if siege battles were that complex, I still likely wouldn't be interested in playing them. You see, the majority of these battles take place at the end of the game, but after playing for 40 plus hours, I was like, when's this game gonna end?
Now, this is gonna split people.
You see, movies are often criticized for their length, many tout it as being too long. But video games rarely, if ever, get this criticism. I guess because games are pricier and gamers want to make sure they get their money's worth. But this mindset leads a lot of developers to artificially extend their game. Because anyone who says,
game's too long,
are going to get swarmed with comments of people saying,
lol, did that twat just say the game has too much content? What the hell? But if you've played Shadow of War, you might just feel that way.
The game continues with these siege missions after the story wraps up, and I was there like,
look, I haven't gotten around to playing the new South Park yet. I want my life back, game.
Now, I'm not saying the game is bad here. It's just, Shadow of War basically boils down to just killing orcs. Everywhere you go, there's more of them. Every mission you do has you killing them in droves.
It's fun. Very fun, in fact. For about 10 to 30 hours, but for 40 or even 50?
For the game's length, there needed to be more of it here. A Shadow of War, I'd describe it as just a bloated Shadow of Mordor. It's about twice as long and the world is bigger, but the game is more of just the same, so the extended game time feels a bit out of place, especially considering that by playing Shadow of Mordor, you'll experience 90% of what Shadow of War has to offer.
So yeah, the game sadly outstayed its welcome for me.
Honestly, I'd go as far as to say to not even play past the final boss and just watch the ending cutscene on YouTube, because the final slog to the game's end, I don't think is worth it.
Yeah, me advising not to even finish the game, it's not a good sign.
If you disagree with me, I totally get why. It's just how I feel.
Oh, and speaking of things that aren't a good sign.
Number 5. Free-to-play, awful RRP. Why not both?
Yep, Shadow of War is yet another game privy to those money-grabbing practices publishers love oh so much these days.
Season Pass, 33 quid, which makes it more expensive than the game itself. What the hell? And there's also dreaded microtransactions.
Oh, that's just grand as that.
I do take offense that these are here, cause microtransactions just have no place in a game that can sell for 80 quid for the gold edition.
But in the game's defense, the microtransactions are beyond pointless to buy, as all it nets you is extra orcs and gear.
The gear of which is useless, cause as Talion levels up, the gear does not, so any gear you buy will be made redundant pretty quickly.
And the orcs? Why would you buy them?
The game is practically all about recruiting orcs into your army, so why pay money to bypass the objective you already paid for the privilege to do?
If you fork over money in this game, you're insane.
So yeah, the microtransactions are completely pointless.
Which is good, I guess, because that means it's not pay to win.
But it makes me wonder why they're even here at all. I guess some dumbasses are buying. For what it's worth, I can say that if microtransactions have to be in a game, then this I can live with. But I'm still knocking a point from my final score of this game as a matter of principle. Anyway, let's move on. Number 6. As visually appealing as Mordor can be. Now in terms of graphics, Shadow of War is good. Not mind-blowingly so, and Mordor can look a bit stale at times. But there's a reason for that. It's Mordor. But even when working with such a dire place, the game can have its visually pleasing moments, most of which occur in the canon side missions. So yeah, it's a solid looking title, and the framerate holds up very nicely, even on the base console models. I played this on the original Xbox One, and yeah, textures take a hit, and you're certainly not achieving 60fps, but it's a consistent 30, and I haven't had a single crash in my playthrough.
Can't complain. And this is especially impressive considering the sheer amount of enemies on screen at a time.
For a game to look as good as this, and to have this much to render on screen at the same time with no framerate drops,
that is remarkable game engine optimization. Nice work there, Monolith.
Music is also enjoyable, with the orc chants being a great highlight, and the voice cast are all on point. I was surprised to see that it was Pollyanna McIntosh doing the voice of Shelob. Yeah, that crazy scavenger lady from Walking Dead. Yeah, she does a great job. Gideon Emery seems to be rivaling Troy Baker for great video game roles now, and his portrayal of Bruce especially cracked me up. And major props go to Liam O'Brien, who does a spectacular job as Gollum.
Seriously, I thought they got Andy Serkis to voice him. To find out it was another guy that played him? That's some talent right there.
And finally, just a quick mention about load times. They're often a bit longer than desired. Traveling between regions really tests your patience. If you're on PC, then I should imagine this is better, but on console it's pretty bad, especially when you're doing Celebrimbor's challenge missions, because resetting these when you screwed something up will have you twiddling your thumbs more times than you can count.
So that's just about everything. Here are my final thoughts.
Middle-earth Shadow of War is a fun but overly familiar and kinda bloated experience. It's got great combat, the Nemesis system continues to shine, and it uses the Lord of the Rings license to great effect. But the game overstays its welcome, more could have been done with the narrative, it feels a bit too similar to Shadow of Mordor for my tastes, and of course you got the microtransactions and the expensive as hell season pass.
That all accumulates to a score of a high 7.
If you liked Shadow of Mordor and you fancy yourselves another 40 plus hours of that, yeah, Shadow of War comes highly recommended. Just realise there's not too many surprises in store here.
But I am hoping for another step up for Lord of the Rings in the gaming scene.
I mean, if Lord of the Rings are going to take on Game of Thrones on TV, then in the video game world, I want to see Lord of the Rings take on Skyrim. I want to see a true non-MMO open world Lord of the Rings game, where you can visit everywhere from Valinor to Mirkwood, choose a race, customize your character, get involved in a unique but involving storyline, ride a horse over Pelennor Fields, go mining for some Mithril and Moria, climb up the Tower of Isengard, and hop on an eagle and get down again.
There's just so much untapped potential here, and I pray that a video game developer will one day take this daunting project on.
In the meantime, Shadow of War comes recommended.
Provided your own personal desires for a Middle-earth game are a little more modest than my own. I'll see you guys next time. Hey guys, just wanted to give a massive thank you and shout out to the illustrious Ilnej for helping out with the Pokeox skit. If you like my videos, I'm confident you'll love his. He does movie reviews, music videos, and all sorts of great stuff. Definitely give him a watch. Link to his channel is in the description. You won't regret it. Thanks again for watching, guys. Peace out.